Everyone, I think we'll make a start as we're running a little bit late and I don't want to overrun into your lunch times. So my name's Tom Fithian. I'm from Capgemini, and it's a real pleasure to be here today to talk to you and share some of the work that we've been doing as Capgemini with Royal Mail Group over the last 5 years. We'll run through just a bit of a general introduction, give you some background on who the Royal Mail are. I imagine a lot of people won't know, and talk about how Capgemini are working with them. We'll talk about the RMG e-business platform, which is the big Drupal element of what we're doing with them. Then we'll go on, and Charlie, my colleague, will go on to talk about how we deliver projects for Royal Mail at scale. And we'll talk a little bit more about how we're evolving the platform and looking forward, looking at some of the innovations that Dries talked about in the keynote this morning, and how that's changing what enterprises are doing the world over. So as I said, I'm Tom. I've been with Capgemini for about 5 years. I'm the web platforms team lead in the UK, so I lead our Drupal capability in the UK, which is a team of around about 30 developers. And then I have some really close links with my colleagues here in India, who also lead the Drupal practice over here. As I said, I've been working with Royal Mail Group since 2011, and if you want to get in touch after the talk, then please feel free.
Hi everybody, I'm Charlie Dawkins. I am an engagement manager, project manager, for anybody who doesn't know how to translate that, with Capgemini. I've been with Capgemini since 1997, when I used to have black hair rather than grey hair. I'm actually responsible for the delivery of e-business within Capgemini. It's my job to make sure that we deliver everything that Royal Mail wants. I lead a combined team of UK and India resources. And I've also been working on Royal Mail since 2011.
So just to give a bit of context about who the Royal Mail Group are. So in the UK, the Royal Mail are the designated universal postal provider. So they deliver 6 days a week, one price on a stamp, goes anywhere, to all 29 million households in the UK. So they're a really large part of the UK economy and the UK marketplace. And they also have different divisions who work across Europe. So they've got a logistics business called General Logistics Systems, who operate right across Europe. They're also one of the oldest companies in the world, so they're celebrating their 500th anniversary this year. Really established organization, and we'll talk about some of their history. They're also a very forward-thinking, innovative company, and that was recognized last year here in Mumbai when some of Royal Mail's leadership team came over to receive an award at the NASCOM conference for innovation. So to bring some more context in, some of the numbers around Royal Mail mentioned 29 million households in the UK that Royal Mail have to deliver to every day. That equates to around about 13 billion letters and 1.1 billion parcels every year. They're the sixth largest contributor to the UK economy, and they employ around about 162,000 people for most of the year. That does rise to around about 180,000 people at Christmas time, which is one of Royal Mail's busiest times of the year. And again, we'll talk a bit more about Christmas. And that parcels number, that equates to around about half of the parcels in the UK are sent through Royal Mail. Capgemini, I'm sure a lot of people know who Capgemini are, and I know we've got some of my colleagues in the audience and former colleagues in the audience as well. So Capgemini are one of the world's foremost providers of technology and consulting services. And we deliver right across the globe, around about 180,000 people across 40 countries. And it's great to be here giving this talk in Mumbai, in India, because India is a really important part of what Capgemini does. Nearly half of all the people in Capgemini are in India. We started here in Mumbai in 2001. So really, really important to us. It's a real hub for innovation. So we've got centers of excellence in India for digital customer experience, for mobile, and for testing services. Going back to Royal Mail, some of the background around some of the challenges that Royal Mail faced when we started working with them. Customers, as we all know, customers are moving through this digital evolution of technology, and are wanting more and more digital services to interact with organizations. So Royal Mail wanted to make sure they were investing properly in their digital channels. The needs and the wants of those customers were changing using that technology. Dries talked about some of the notifications and push models and different models of digital interaction in this keynote this morning, and that's very, very true, particularly when you think around something like receiving a parcel or sending a mail item. So again, Royal Mail wanted to address those customer needs and target some really high-value customers in terms of all the organisations who are booming in terms of online dispatch and delivery. And then finally, they had a bit of an ageing platform at the time that we started working with them, and that's holding them back, limiting the rate at which they can respond to demands in the marketplace. So one of the key drivers was to make sure that the platform that we designed and delivered was flexible and could evolve and not hold them back at any point in the future. So back in 2010, Capgemini and Royal Mail Group started working together to transform Royal Mail's business and consumer online services. It started out very much as a partnership focusing on the online channels and the digital experience, but over the last 5-6 years, that's expanded into how we can use technology to evolve and enhance their operational delivery systems and their working processes to make them more efficient as an organisation and increase their competitive edge. So we've sort of ended up now, 6 years on, with a really mature, structured and collaborative partnership, which is able to take the best really of both organisations and combine that culture to deliver success. So there's been, in the 6 years, some major events for Royal Mail that we've been a part of together. Back in 2012, London hosted the Olympics, which was a really big event for the UK as a whole, but Royal Mail, as one of those leading brands in the UK, took a real part in everything that was going on with the Olympics. So one of their commitments at the start was every time Great Britain team won a gold medal, they committed that they would have a stamp issued by the next day with that athlete on it. And it turned out that Great Britain actually did quite well at the Olympics for once, which was fairly unusual. So there was a lot of stamps, a lot of focus, a lot of media coverage on that, and that drove a lot of traffic to the e-business platform through all their digital channels. But also had that real focus on how operationally transforming something that was a piece of artwork that didn't exist 24 hours ago could then be on a stamp that was being put on letters going around the UK was a real achievement. Around about a year later, Royal Mail, who up until 2013 were a publicly owned company, the right way around, they privatised. They floated on the UK stock market. And that had a different kind of focus. Media presence, investor relations, all that kind of thing was really, really key to making sure that the share price got off to the best possible start and that the IPO could take place successfully. Not so much a one-off event, but as I touched on, Christmas is a really key time of the year for Royal Mail. They start planning for Christmas in around about April. Looking at the patterns of the previous year, looking at what they need to do from both people, operations and technology perspective to support the following Christmas. And Royal Mail, because of their obligation to deliver everywhere, every day in the UK, they act as the overflow capacity for the other distribution companies in the UK who maybe at that time of the year can't cope or don't have enough capacity to deliver all the parcels at Christmas time. And again, I talked a bit about the celebrations this year of Royal Mail's 500th anniversary, and looking back at that, recognising some of the innovations that Royal Mail have done throughout their history and continue to do today. So right back from the invention of the world's first stamp, which we think of as a given today, through to, in 2004, creating the first digital stamp that could be bought and printed off online, and they're looking today at how they can evolve that even further. Now I'll talk a bit about the bits that you're probably all here to hear about, which is the e-business platform and Drupal's involvement in it. So as I said, Royal Mail's e-business platform is their primary online channel. It's the front door to their organisation, the customer, and it gives them e-commerce, consumer services and business services all online. Built, hosted and is maintained and we're still building and enhancing it today by Capgemini. And from a consumer perspective, it consists really of five primary sites. It's a bit more difficult. There's five key brands, essentially. There's the Royal Mail Letters, which is royalmail.com, which is a consumer-focused channel around how everybody in the UK can interact with Royal Mail services. There's then a business-focused portal, the Royal Mail Business Portal, which is focused on helping small and medium enterprises find new ways to grow and almost have a one-stop shop for buying Royal Mail services and using Royal Mail to support their business. Then there's Parcelforce Worldwide, who are Royal Mail's sort of specialist courier service. There's the Royal Mail Group website, which is the corporate and media investor relations sort of content. And then talking about some of the changes in the operational space, there's a service that we launched fairly recently called MailMark, which is around putting a barcode on every single item of mail that goes through Royal Mail systems, particularly for really large organisations sending millions of items of mail every week. That's a key innovation that was both a digital channel but also operational change for Royal Mail. We support around about 100 different applications and API services through the platform. And it's not just Drupal, as we'll see a little later. It's a combination of the best of open source technology, software as a service, but also some proprietary on-premise technologies as well. With that key of making it a pluggable architecture that as new technologies come along and become a key avenue for us, we can add them to the architecture, remove things which maybe have technology. So here's just a quick click through the rawmail.com consumer website. Give a flavour of some of the different branding presences. This is the business portal for small medium enterprises, Parcelforce Worldwide, and RoyalMailGroup.com. You can see much more emphasis there on the content about RoyalMail rather than necessarily their services. We talked a bit about RoyalMail and their history, inventing stamps and putting a stamp on letters and creating digital stamps today. They're more than just creating stamps, and so the applications that we build and that we support are much more than just about creating and printing stamps. So the first application is called Track and Trace, and this is just to bring a selection of them through. So when a user is ordering a parcel or bought something, maybe through Amazon or any other online retailer, they're often given a tracking number, and then they can come to the website and they can look up the status of that delivery. So they can work out when it's going to be delivered, what status this is. Maybe it's already been delivered whilst they've been at work, and they can see here the signature at the bottom, which is the proof of delivery. Maybe it's been delivered to a neighbour. It's worth mentioning for Track and Trace, as well as providing the website interface, we also provide a number of APIs. So that allows partner organisations to talk through to get the tracking status information for embedding on their own websites. So if, for example, you're looking at the status of a parcel from Amazon and it's been dispatched with Royal Mail, you're seeing the service that's being called by Amazon to get that status. Most important thing if you are sending a letter is making sure you get the address right, make sure it goes to the right place. And so we provide a service which looks up, validates, and also confirms the full address of where someone's wanting to send it to. And then from there, the user can go off and buy the postage online or get directions to that address if actually they're just curious about where that place is. Then we move into some of the more or less obvious services, I guess. So this service called Redirections. When someone's moving house in the UK, as I'm sure is the same the world over, it's quite a stressful experience, and you don't necessarily want to be changing the address on everything the day you're going to move. So the redirection service that Royal Mail provides lets you essentially buy a subscription for 3, 6, or 12 months where you can have your mail redirected from your old address to your new address. And again, the user interface for that and deploying that is all built through Drupal, talking to Royal Mail's back-end distribution services to make sure that takes place and lets that activity occur. In terms of receiving a parcel, maybe you're out, maybe the parcel's delivered whilst you were at the shops or at work. Royal Mail posts this card through the door which says, we missed you when we tried to deliver. And they keep that parcel safe. They make sure that they're not just leaving it on the doorstep or leaving it somewhere insecure. They will then let you book and reschedule that delivery online so that you can have it delivered at a time that's suitable to you. And then we do get onto stamps, and this is one of the avenues for the digital stamps that we talked about. So online postage is a service that lets you, as someone who's wanting to send a parcel, put in all the attributes of that parcel, so weight and size and where you want it to go to work out the pricing, and then actually print that off on your computer at home. And that's useful for people who are maybe selling items through eBay or other online marketplaces, and generates this label. And the really important bit there is the the barcode that contains all the data about where that item of mail should go and what's been paid for it to make sure that it gets to the right destination. And again, that's a service that has both the online user interaction, user interface approach to it, but is also then provided as a set of APIs that allows really big partners who are doing a lot of transactions through this to generate those labels, generate those barcodes as an API service. So that's a really important part of the platform. As you probably start to realize, and as I touched on, there's a complex architecture behind all of this. It's not just Drupal. We wouldn't want it to be just Drupal because there's quite a few headaches in there that unfortunately Drupal wouldn't necessarily be the right solution for. So this is the architecture. And I'm not expecting you to be able to see all of the individual services on there, but it's really to give a flavor of just how many products and services there are within the architecture. What you can see at the top row is the personalization and interaction element, and that's where Drupal's primary focus is. So that's providing the content management, personalization, e-commerce, integration with search and multivariate testing services like WebTrends that are up there. But also does touch into the service integration layer in the middle, providing some of those APIs that we talked about. But for APIs that are pure integration, we don't want them to go through Drupal, mainly for reasons of scale and efficiency. So we use integration technologies like Apache Camel, which is a Java framework, to provide those APIs in that integration tier. And then we've got things which, again, we wouldn't want to manage natively within Drupal. We've got integration with payment gateways. So we use a company called DataCash, who are part of the MasterCard group, to ensure the PCI compliance of all the credit card transactions that we take hold of. We use hosting partners, some of the others that are worth calling out. We have integration with some SaaS CRM providers, so we use Salesforce as a customer and relationship management. All integrated with Drupal, and Drupal are a really important part of it. We're just bringing some of that flavor of the variety of applications that we're supporting. So I talked a bit about already where Drupal does fit in with that, and essentially everything that the user can see that is Raw Mail's online presence, they're seeing Drupal. They're seeing that. We've got a mixture of Drupal 6 and Drupal 7 sites, one Drupal 6 site left, we're excited to see Drupal 8 and the possibilities that gives us, but we're still with 6 and 7 at the moment. We're doing content and campaign management through Drupal. We're doing user profile management. So although we're using a single sign-on solution, we're allowing the user to access and update their user profile through the user profile management screens in Drupal. All the user-facing applications and e-commerce applications are Drupal, using the Drupal Commerce modules. Some of the interfaces that the customer contact centers use are also Drupal screens. And then, as I mentioned, there are a few APIs where the selection is right for it to be presented as a service from Drupal, so using Drupal services capabilities for that. Talked a bit about it being a high-scale platform, and we had some of the numbers about Royal Mail earlier. So this brings in what we're supporting in terms of traffic to the platform. So we're doing, on average, around about 62 million page views every month. There's about 7 million registered users, which, although in a country the size of India probably doesn't seem like very many, that's around about 10% of the UK population have got an account with Royal Mail. So it gives a flavour of the scale in terms of the UK operations. The tracking requests that I mentioned for the parcel tracking, we're doing around about 60 tracking requests every second. And since we launched the e-commerce aspects of the platform back in late 2011, we've done around about 54 million e-commerce transactions. So quite a throughput and quite an important part of Royal Mail's revenue generation. And some of the trends around that, we talked about the Christmas pressure. And that 62 million average throughout the year increases by about 60% through the last quarter of the year to 95 million page views in December last year, and around about 12 million unique visitors in December. So again, you see the importance of that Christmas time, the pressures there, people wanting to know where their parcels are, people coming online to generate the postage for sending presents to their families and friends. And that drives a lot of traffic through the platform. So talking a bit more technically about some of the things that we've done to make Drupal scale to support some of those numbers, because we think the numbers that we've got make that set of sites one of the largest Drupal implementations, certainly in Europe. So we do object caching, so we use Memcache, which I'm sure a lot of people here will have used, to minimize the number of queries that we're making to the database. A lot of the transactions don't need to go to the database every time to generate their information, so we'll cache that in Memcache. And then in terms of the output that gets generated, we're also using reverse proxy caching. So we're using a product called Stingray, which is a reverse proxy cache for caching the generated HTML of page. So again, we're minimizing the number of bootstraps that Drupal needs to do. Talk about the database and how important the database is. We want to make sure that database is as tuned and running as efficiently as possible. So talking about things like having 54 million orders in our Drupal Commerce installation, really key to make sure that our indexing is correct on our databases, that anything that we're exposing as a custom view, we've made sure that we've double-checked that the entities and the things that we're sorting on or searching on are properly indexed. And one of the related ones on the database there is revisioning, actually. So we had a nice gotcha, which it's nice to see Alex in the audience. He actually, when he was working with us, found this nuance of how Drupal 7's field system worked. And even with revisioning disabled in Drupal 7, if you've got custom fields on an entity, Drupal still writes to the revision table. It doesn't create all the history of the revisions, but it does do the write to the revisions table. So that was causing more queries than we needed to the database. And so the module field SQL no revisions was born, contributed back to Drupal.org, and is still active today. And that basically eliminates those extra writes. So through installing one module, which effectively is defining a new database backend for Drupal, we halve the number of write queries on an entity insert or update where revisioning wasn't important. So that had some real big benefits for us. Some of the other ones, which again are fairly common, so I won't go too much into detail, but not processing everything synchronously. So using Drupal's queue API to queue up requests and make sure that you can back off requests and smooth out the peaks and troughs in demand. Not making cron do everything in the background, but splitting out the jobs and making sure that you're isolating those, running them when you want to, and having the impact that you want them to. And then on PHP versions, and this is one of the biggest single wins for us that we essentially get for free by the PHP community being as great as it is in terms of looking at performance. The increases in performance that we get between PHP 5.3 and 5.4, and then more recently 5.4 to 5.5, have been absolutely huge. I think Charlie's got some numbers when he talks in a little bit. But real big benefits, and looking at what's happening with PHP 7, we're sort of investigating how feasible it is for us to get Drupal 6 running on PHP 7, which, having done the work for getting to 5.5, is the good news is it's not too much extra effort. So that's hopefully something we'll be doing in the future. So now I will hand over to Charlie, and he's going to talk a bit about how we work as a team, how we organize ourselves, and how we deliver projects at this kind of scale.
Thank you very much, Tom. Okay, so the first thing I just want to say is for Royal Mail, it's not just Capgemini. They have a multi-partner ecosystem. So there's lots of involvement from Accenture, Atos, HCL, and CSC. And in fact, I'm involved in a go-live 4 o'clock in the morning tomorrow, where essentially Atos, HCL, and CSC and Capgemini are involved. So that's going to be fun for 8 hours. What we have is a one-team approach. We try to amalgamate as much as we can between our project team and our service team. In the UK, we have roughly about 40 staff, whereas 36 of them are working on projects, and 4 of them are on the service team. Whereas in India, we have 33 on the projects team and 50 plus, there's more than 50 actually, on the service side. So how do we work? Well, we have two speeds of change that we do. We have two lanes. One is we call our core, which essentially is we're delivering every 4 weeks into the production. We try to do it faster. We've tried to do it slower. We've done pretty much 4 weeks now for the last 2 years. It works very well. It's a challenge, yeah? Always trying to deliver something into production every 4 weeks, where major enhancements are going on at the same time, is a challenge, but we've been able to do it continuously now for 2 years. There is continual improvement of what we're trying to do. We're trying to improve everything that we do each time. We try to do more automated testing, etc., and try to get things out there a lot faster. The full weekly cycle is so we can do some rapid response to the client. Got something they want to do within 4 weeks, to put it in the backlog for that full weekly cycle, and therefore they know they're going to get it in production within 4 weeks. Of course, the content, they can change the content anytime they like, and they do change the content continuously. The full weekly gives us a scaffold for all of our other activities that we do. Every 4 weeks we do performance testing. We do a full end-to-end performance test of all of our websites. We do a full platform regression test. Quite a lot of that is automated, but it's also some of that is done manually. And our deployment process and our coordination is the same. We build, we deploy exactly the same all the time. Typically, in one of those 4 weekly releases, we do about 20 to 30 items. Yeah, sometimes we can go as low as 6 or 7, but yeah, mostly 20 to 30. In parallel with that, we have bigger projects running. These are usually 3, 4, 5 months, and sometimes as long as a year. Typically, we have about 4 of these running in parallel. We have got up to 5 or 6, and essentially it's a dedicated project team that's working in parallel with the existing core team. They will run their own development, their own testing, they have their own Scrum Master, stroke project manager, and they try to merge what their releases are into our monthly cycle because it's easier, because of the scaffolding that we have in place. But of course, there's sometimes where we have to do it outside of that monthly cycle because of pressures from the business. So our monthly release cycle, essentially we've got a 4-week sprint. It is a little bit waterfall towards the end. We do have a UAT step at the end on the 4 weeks, on the 4th week, and we also do have a PVT test that we run after that. But essentially we are iteratively building the features that our client wants over a 3-week period, fixing it in the 4th week if there's any bugs. Yes, there are, sorry. And actually we start the next sprint in parallel now with the 4th week. We always used to keep that exactly, it's 4 weeks, but the capacity of the core team, the number of defects that we get is actually quite low, so they can actually start in the new features of the following sprint in parallel with that 4th week. We have a cross-functional team. We have project managers, people like myself, stroke scrum masters, solution architects. Tom's already mentioned we have CAML, which is our Java framework for doing our integration. We're doing a lot more integration work at the moment, so that's actually quite key for us. We've got the Drupal team, of course, there's a business analyst and testers. Those roles can scale up depending on how much work we've got. If we've got a bigger project, yeah, we might scale that up to have 4 or 5 Drupal people, we have 1 or 2 integration people and more testers. We can also scale to multiple teams, so we try and keep the same sort of team structure, and also some of those roles can be shared across teams. So sometimes our Scrum Master could be looking after 2 teams, our Solution Architect could be looking after, you know, 3 or 4 of the teams. What is really key to us is the quality of what we deliver, and what is key to the client is the quality of what we deliver. They are very, very much of, it's got to be right, guys. It's quite surprising for websites sometimes, but yeah, having come from a real-time background of defense and stuff like that, sometimes it feels a little bit OTT, but we keep to it, and we try our hardest to give them exactly the quality of what they desire. So all of our developers have Vagrant Machine. They will develop their code in a feature branch. They will commit that and push it through to Git, create a pull request, and which automatically will run the unit tests and the code style checker. There's also manual code reviews, so people are invited to code review, and we have a process in place where we say we have to have 2 approvers, and we like to make the whole team, if possible, review code, Yeah, everyone's invited, everyone can look. It's a learning curve. It's not just, you know, being picky about people's code. It actually is a learning curve as well for everybody concerned. Most of the pull requests into the develop branch, and then nightly we do a build. Automatically does around about 11 o'clock-ish, depending on which site it is. And that will then run a number of automated BHAT scripts to make sure everything's okay. We actually do get emails come out to tell us how those BHAT scripts worked. And then some of our features, because they're new features, we're not into doing BDD at the minute or test-driven development. We're trying it, but we're not getting there. We have still quite a lot of manual testing that's done. One of the main things that we use is Slack for our communication, for our collaboration between the teams. We love Slack. Yeah, it's really good. Right, gets too techy now, and I have to hand back.
Thanks, Charlie. So Charlie talked about the regular, repeatable build process that we've built up over the years. And that is really, really key to the success of the platform. It's able to be the same process that we're running in development, in test, and then our ultimate production deployments. So just talking through some of the components that make up that build process. I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with Drush Make. So we're using Drush Make to effectively assemble our site and do the initial build. So it's checking out the code from the various repositories and assembling that into the Drupal site route. Fetching and applying any patches that we might have either submitted to Drupal.org that haven't yet been committed, or patches that other people have submitted as well. And then we execute the site install. Around that, we've then got Capistrano, which is a Ruby-based build and deployment tool. We use as a wrapper to Drush Make, mainly so that we can take advantage of running some of the other commands that Drush won't give us, but also managing the configuration that we want to apply to different environments. So what we've built out is a means to define configuration on a per environment basis, provide overrides to production, and essentially merge those settings together so that if we've got different endpoints in test environments, if we've got different settings because we're building something new and that's entailed an evolution of the configuration, we're managing it there. One of the items in Drupal 8, we're really excited to see what the configuration management initiative can bring to our build process, and that's something we're exploring at the moment. And then the final part of Capistrano is we use the rsync deployment strategy in Capistrano, so that regardless of whether we're deploying to a single server QA environment or a high number of servers in a pre-production or production environment, we're using exactly the same build and deploy steps every time. In terms of those environment configurations, the services that are set up in the environment and running around that, we're using Puppet for the configuration management of that and the installation of the different services. And again, that's hooked up to jobs that we can just build an environment through a Jenkins job and build that with the configuration that we're expecting. So really, really key to enabling us to stand up a new environment if we've got a new project that needs a dedicated test environment, for example. And then I mentioned Jenkins, and we're using that as the job scheduler, managing when the jobs run, who can run them, or whether they're going to run automatically, but also managing the pipeline of events. So rather than having a single job that's doing all the build and test, splitting up so that if the build succeeds, it then kicks off the testing jobs that Charlie talked about. And we use the trend analysis there to look at what's passing and failing, and also look at things like the unit test coverage, the code style metrics, just to see our view on quality over time. So as I said, we started out with the platform nearly 6 years ago, and it's evolved over that time and will continue to evolve. So I just wanted to talk through a couple of things that we've done in as part of that evolution. Dries talked in the keynote this morning about the move to more modern web architectures, and Drupal, very much, certainly Drupal 6 and 7, very much built around the traditional web architecture, where the browser's making requests, coming through the firewall and hitting a web application server, and then that's doing the orchestration of requests through an integration tier or off to the database, and so on. So pretty much your web application in that architecture is doing all of the heavy lifting and all of the orchestration. The more modern web application architecture that allows for some of the decoupled front ends that Dries was talking about still has that web application tier responding to requests, but also adds in the browser making through JavaScript frameworks like AngularJS, Backbone, or Ember, talking through directly to an integration tier to build services. And essentially comes back to the concept of eliminating Drupal bootstraps where we don't need them. So if we're getting something from a back-end API or service, we don't need Drupal to tell us that, so we can go and talk to that directly, and also then expose those through multiple channels, multiple partners. So what does that look like? So this is one of the applications where we've taken this approach on. It's called Price Finder, where a user is able to enter a bunch of parameters about the item that they're sending through the mail and come up with a price and the other attributes of that service that they're going to pick. So what we do is we're using Drupal to provision the underlying page or the menu, help content and supporting content like that, the footers, all brought in and provisioned through Drupal. And in this case, we're using panels and page manager to assemble that page. And then essentially, we've got a pane that is the grayed out area in the middle, and that's instantiating an AngularJS application. So all of the attributes about where you're sending to, so we've got UK overseas, or whether you're sending to one of the armed forces, the item that you're sending, the size and the price, are all accessed via APIs that are implemented in our Java CAML integration tier. And then the most important thing is that to the user, they don't care about any of that. They're getting a seamless, responsive, cohesive user experience presented to them, with Drupal providing that wrapper, but those services evolving underneath. The other real big win that gives us is we talked a bit about the number of different sites with different user interfaces and different themes, and also the mix of Drupal versions. And building things in that way lets us have a single tier providing the APIs, but then lets us move the AngularJS between different Drupal versions, between different applications, and even give that code to partners of Royal Mail to put on their own sites, still accessing the APIs, still doing it consistently. We've not had to rewrite the code four or five different times for those different implementations. Following on from that, we've also begun to create more in the way of shared services. And what I mean by shared services is really the same thing that I was talking about in the previous section, but wrapping up both API integration and UI presentation layers. So in the integration tier, we're creating we're using a microservices type architecture to build small independent API services, which we can glue together in different ways to create new services and create new capabilities. That then gives us a pattern for building those services to federate them with partners and other customers. And so to bring that to life a little bit, the first example that we're doing with this is a shared payment service. So previously, we had all our credit card integration with the payment gateway that I talked about earlier, implemented almost on a case-by-case basis through those payment journeys. And if someone was building a non-Drupal application that maybe needed to be part of Royal Mail's estate, or was a partner application, they'd have to build their own implementation to those payment gateways. So what we've created is essentially, and it's development work that's going on at the moment, is a payment service that wraps that and allows any Royal Mail service or partner to integrate to it and come up with a set of payment mechanisms. So that might be a credit or debit card payment, it might be a PayPal integration, or it might be using some of Royal Mail's internal charging mechanisms, and gives that ability to swap in and out different payment gateways, different payment methods, without the integration from the applications changing. So this is a real avenue that we're looking for the future on an approach to building some of these user interfaces and let Royal Mail get the maximum use out of them, even for elements that might not be within the core e-business platform. Then the other aspect that's really important to us is how we code for the future, being aware of things like Drupal 8 coming out, things like architecture techniques evolving. So there's a lot of work we do on how we're going to manage our code, how we're going to write our code. So one of those approaches is making sure that we're building reusable components. So we're taking very much an approach of building reusable PHP libraries rather than necessarily writing a new Drupal module every time, and using object-orientated approaches, which again, more and more prevalent in Drupal 8 now, to increase the portability between versions. Again, a PHP version, we can easily lift and shift between Drupal 6, between Drupal 7, and when we eventually move to Drupal 8, we'll be able to use that same library in Drupal 8. And also testability of those libraries. So by building something as a standalone unit testable library, as I'm sure many of you have found, unit testing in Drupal 6, in Drupal 7 is a hard problem to solve. So the more we can separate out and just build standalone PHP, that gives us a lot of benefit. We've also started using Symfony components in our Drupal 6 and 7 sites. So I sat in the audience at DrupalCon Denver when Dries and Fabien Potentio announced the collaboration between the Drupal project and Symfony. And around about the same time, we started looking at, okay, how can we take advantage of how some of this could help us with Drupal 6 and Drupal 7. So again, we've created another contributed module to provide a wrapper between Drupal 6, Drupal 7, and Symfony's dependency injection container, which then lets us bring in a lot of the other Symfony components. So we're using things like the event dispatcher, some of the file system components, and the form validator components. Again, similar reasons to why we've write PHP libraries, really standardization. So Symfony's use of design patterns means that for developers who are new to Drupal and have maybe come from other programming backgrounds, the patterns are a lot more familiar. Portability, again, we can move those components and how we're integrating with those components between Drupal versions more easily. And also preparing for the future, upskilling our team, making sure they're aware of what Symfony can bring to the party, how we can use it, and how it could work with Drupal, so that when we do come to Drupal 8, as we're now starting to look at, we can get a head start. You listened to us talk for quite a while now, and I think we're not doing too bad for time. We also had hoped to be joined by one of our colleagues from Royal Mail, but unfortunately travel plans meant that he couldn't make it at the last minute. So he's given us a short video, which we'll play through now.
Hi, I'm Paul Sarch. I'm the e-business program director at Royal Mail Group. I work in our Mount Pleasant office in Farringdon in London. At the moment, Royal Mail is undertaking one of the largest industrial transformation of its kind. E-business is key to the way that our customers interact with us. It's our primary web channel, it's our e-commerce channel, and it provides self-service products and services. It's hosted and maintained by Capgemini, and it's supported in collaboration with Royal Mail. So the e-business platform is Royal Mail's front door for its customers. We provide that service through our four key websites, which is Royal Mail Group, Royal Mail Letters, Royal Mail Letters Business, and Parcel Force Worldwide. So Drupal gives our business users a flexible and efficient content management system, but we've taken it one step further than that. So we've now got complex applications developed in Drupal. That's enabled the business to move on at pace and deliver the service that our customers expect from us. So fewer people are going shopping anymore. They're all ordering online. Online market sales, market sellers are increasing. They've got to post it somewhere, post it Royal Mail, and we're able to track it, tell people where it's going to be, when it's going to be delivered, and we're hitting another marketplace. So I think one of the key things for me in this is that we all share the same value. We all want to do what's right by the customer. We want to give the ultimate customer experience. Working together and bringing the different skills that everybody's got to the table, working together, discussing, disagreeing sometimes, not always agreeing. So, you know, but we come out with the right answer for the customer and the businesses.
So really that brings us to the end of what we're going to share, and it's great to hear from Paul there, not just someone who comes from a Drupal development background saying how great Drupal's been, but hearing the client give us the thumbs up as to the real change that the Drupal and the e-business platform has been able to bring to. As Paul said, it's a really important time in Royal Mail's history. The distribution market has got really high levels of competition and innovation going on, and that landscape is really rapidly changing. So Drupal's enabling Royal Mail to respond to that challenge, respond to that change, and support the transformation of their organisation. We're really looking forward to what the next 5 or 6 years might bring, and from working together, and we're looking forward to how Drupal can be a part of that. Thanks all for listening. It's been a real privilege to be able to talk to you today and share what we've been doing. And if you've got any questions, then please feel free. I'll be happy to answer. Thank you.
you so much. It was a fantastic presentation. Thank you for sharing so many details about your stack and the techniques. It's kind of amazing, the size of your operation. I don't know, so that was I wasn't aware of Apache Camel. And I was kind of wondering how you manage that API ecosystem. And I was wondering, you know, with vendors out there like, you know, Apigee and MuleSoft and, you know, so on and so forth, I think there's a UK one, NetKernel. Have you guys entertained the idea of maybe bringing on that as a service and, you know, what you would gain from that kind of management layer?
And so in terms of looking at the alternatives, we did an evaluation comparing Camel and Mule. And at the time, just the slightly more lightweight approach that Camel was taking gave us some quick wins. It was a bit more oriented. And I'll do a slight disclaimer of not being an expert in Java and the integration technologies, but gave us a bit more flexibility about how we wanted to manage the architecture. In terms of exposing those APIs to the outside world, you're right, that API management piece is key, and there's some work undergoing at the moment to transform that around how we federate those APIs out, both to consumer organizations, but also to mobile channels and things like that. So it's a good question, and it's one that we don't have a...
Just a quick follow-up. So are all of the clients of your APIs all internal? Is it all, so do you have client-facing APIs or open APIs?
We've got a mixture of both. They're not open, so they're not there for any consumer in the public to access, but partners who have a commercial relationship with RawMail can essentially procure access to those APIs to support their business. So we talked a bit about eBay and Amazon and so on, and they've got that relationship, the partnership with RawMail as their dispatch organization. To manage that. So yeah, there is mechanisms at the moment. We're just looking at how we widen that out and increase that ecosystem.
We're not with the plans with RawMail to expose some of their APIs to the general public. They are nervous about how they go about that, how they say give out the raw plans.
Got this huge ecosystem of all sorts of other tools that you've got plugged in, and it's been going for 5+ years and looks like going on considerable. Have you thought about or experienced where one of those products stops being either relevant to the future or becomes decommissioned, one of the corporate offerings goes under, how you would swap that out and replace it? How do you keep yourself from becoming a legacy?
Yeah, it's a good question actually, and actually there are some bits where we have done that already. So when we first started the platform, our core integration technology wasn't Apache Camel that I mentioned at the start. It was an application called Cordis, which is owned now by OpenText. And there was a move probably about 2.5-3 years ago probably, where we started looking at, okay, what's the longevity of what we're doing all this, how is it supporting what we need to do as a business, and other different alternatives that we should look at. And so that's when then an evaluation effectively kicks off to look at, as I mentioned, we looked at Camel and Mule and a couple of alternatives. And so we gradually phase that in. So rather than saying, right, we're going to take this application that we think maybe isn't part of the long-term future or where we want to build new services, we'll gradually phase that in. So as services are being changed or services are being decommissioned and new ones created, we'll do them in the new technology. So it means that still today there are services running on the platform that are using the Cordis integration technology, but they're certainly a lot less than they were 5 years ago. There's other examples where, I mean, even on the Drupal side, where we're looking at doing more front-end JavaScript framework, not for a moment saying Drupal's becoming legacy or anything like that, but on the 26th of February, I think it is, Drupal 6 effectively does become legacy, so we are looking at ways that we minimise our exposure there. So yeah, there is a reasonably well-trodden path now of how we go, okay, what's coming up, what are the technologies we need to be aware of and keep an eye on, see if they're appropriate, that could enhance what we're doing at the moment, where are the technologies that maybe we're having some problems with, and what's the roadmap to replace those. So it's sort of an ongoing cycle. We certainly look at that sort of each year, right, what are the things we should be considering. Okay, well, I think we're pretty much coming up to lunchtime, so at the risk of making you all hungry, I think we'll end there. So thanks again all for listening. I think the feedback forms are all online. It'd be great to get some feedback left, to see how we can improve the presentation in the future. We've got a Capgemini stand here at DrupalCon. If you'd like to come down and meet some of the team, I'll be there for a little bit, and we've got colleagues from India who will be there throughout the day. So please come and talk to us, and we'll be happy to share some of our experiences. Thank you.